Hello friends, welcome to another video tutorial from Shomu's Biology and the series of videos we are talking about metabolism videos. And mostly in the last couple of videos we talked about carbohydrate metabolism, but from this video we are going to talk about fatty acid metabolism, and especially three parts of the fatty acid metabolism. First is the overview of how fatty acid after digestion is utilized in our body with the help of different receptors. Second part is the fatty acid biosynthesis, and the third, fatty acid beta oxidation, that is the fatty acid degradation. Now the second part of fatty acid biosynthesis is the topic of this video. The term, you say, the production of fatty acids in our body. Now we all know the importance of fatty acids and all the other fat molecules in our body. They are really highly energy conserved molecules. So for making such a high energy producing molecule, we'll also require a lot of energy from outside. So in this anabolic pathway of producing fatty acids, we need several ATP molecules to involve with. And also we need a starter molecule that will start the process. So in this case, the starter molecules that begins the process of fatty acid biosynthesis are acetyl-CoA and NADPH. These are the two molecules that we need to start the process of fatty acid biosynthesis. And I told you that this NADPH, this is a product of pentose phosphate pathway. So if you check your concept earlier, pentose phosphate pathway is really important pathway, because without it we cannot produce NADPH, and without NADPH fatty acids cannot be produced. That's why it's very important to have NADPH concentration in our cell. Now there are several enzymes and ATP molecules required to produce fatty acids. This is the simplest schematic that someone can give you. The idea here in this case of fatty acid production, if you think, the process works in a cytosol of the cell. So in cell, cytosol, acetyl-CoA is required, so as NADPH. We know the pentose phosphate pathway occurs inside the cytosol, so NADPH can easily be produced there and can be utilized. But there is a problem with acetyl-CoA to be brought in the cytosol, because acetyl-CoA is not present in the cytosol normally. Acetyl-CoA is produced from pyruvate. It's converted to acetyl-CoA through pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, but that thing is done in the mitochondria and the matrix of mitochondria. And we also know that acetyl-CoA cannot be transported across the membrane of mitochondria. That creates the first problem of fatty acid biosynthesis. Now, how we get acetyl-CoA in the cytosol from the mitochondrial matrix? And to know that, you simply know, if I draw the mitochondrial structure, the schematic drawing of mitochondria, this is, let's say this is the membrane of mitochondria, somewhat looks like. And then what happens here inside the mitochondria, we know we have the pyruvate, and pyruvate is converted to acetyl-CoA. Now there is no membrane channel through which the acetyl-CoA can come out to the cytosol, but we know that inside the matrix of mitochondria, TCA cycle also carried out, or Krebs cycle also carried out. And we know there are different Krebs cycle intermediates which can have the similar, or which can produce acetyl-CoA outside in the cytosol. So one such molecule that is there in TCA cycle is here citrate. So they produce citrate inside the mitochondrial matrix. Once they produce citrate, the citrate is released out. It can be easily released into the cytosol from mitochondria. So once citrate is out into the cytosol, citrate can be degraded. It can be broken down into two different parts. One is acetyl-CoA, another one is oxaloacetate, with the help of the enzyme known as ATP citrate lyase. This enzyme breaks down citrate into acetyl-CoA and oxaloacetate. Now, acetyl-CoA can be taken for the synthesis of fatty acid with the help of NADPH. So, along with NADPH, can form fatty acid. But what about oxaloacetate? We have oxaloacetate in the cytosol now. So, oxaloacetate is further converted to malate with the help of malate dehydrogenase enzyme and NADP. With the help of malate dehydrogenase, oxaloacetate can be converted to malate. And then later, we can utilize malate to produce pyruvate. In the later stages, malate can be converted to pyruvate. It can be converted back to pyruvate. And once we make pyruvate, then this pyruvate can be taken and inside the mitochondria. Because now the pyruvate can be converted into acetyl-CoA by pyruvate dehydrogenase complex in the matrix of mitochondria. So, this is a cycle that goes on like that. Okay, it produces citrate, transport, then rest of the things. But ultimately, we got our product that we need. And pyruvate is also an important intermediate that is produced at the end. So, this is the process of the first problem to solve. That is a problem with acetyl-CoA. This is one thing that's very important. And the rest of the part about fatty acid biosynthesis is about how exactly for this biosynthesis pathway is the length of the fatty acids. Because you know, fatty acids, they are very long hydrocarbon chain that always form. And the question about it, the second question that I want to ask is how exactly this such a long hydrocarbon chains are formed. And how exactly they make it more complicated like triacyl glycerols. The answer to that, if you think, the whole process takes place in the cytosol. So, it carries some place in the cytosol. So, it has acetyl-CoA and NADPH in there and start adding sequences with one another. But such a long hydrocarbon tail, cytosol is where we have hydrophilic molecules around. So, that is one big problem. So, for a very short lipid chains, short to moderate length lipid chains, the process can take place in the cytosol with the help of other molecules engaging and involving with different hydrocarbon tail which are hydrophobic in nature to form mostly a separate mixture, separated out completely from the rest of the cytosolic component. It can stay there as spheres. But if the hydrocarbon chain is really long, in those cases, the process may not take place properly in the cytosol. In that case, it needs to use any other place a separate compartment in the cell to do the job. The third question that I told you, that what about the complex form of lipids? For example, triacylglycerol. Triacylglycerol is not a unit fatty acid where we have a glycerol backbone, and along with the backbone we have three separate fatty acids linked. So for this type of structures, you know, the glycerol that we are looking and talking about, it is containing a hydroxyl group, hydroxyl bond. It's more like an ethanol type of thing, hydroxyl group. While fatty acids are organic acids, so they have carboxylic group. And it's nothing but the interaction between the hydroxyl group and the carboxyl group together to involve with themselves to form this triacylglycerol-like structures. So now if you get an overview about the process, it's time to check the exact stages of fatty acid biosynthesis. And we not only see that, but also try to watch my video on beta oxidation of fatty acid. And also the third video where I compare between the beta oxidation and the biosynthesis of fatty acids, which you will see most of the steps are very, very similar with the same enzymes involved, but the little difference in the start and end steps and end reaction stages. So watch this video and then check out the rest.
Let's look at the reaction sequence for the biosynthesis of the fatty acids. In the first step of the biosynthesis of fatty acids, the acyl carrier protein or ACP is very important. It plays an important role because this ACP is acetylated by acetyl-CoA. It starts with acetyl-CoA. And once the acyl-CoA or ACP is acetylated, the reaction produces acetyl ACP, and it is catalyzed by acetyl CoA ACP transacylase enzyme. The second step is this acetyl group of the acetyl ACP is transferred to the cis sulfhydryl group on the beta ketoacyl ACP. Okay, and the enzyme involved with this process is beta ketoacyl ACP synthase. Now, thirdly, the malonyl ACP is produced from the malonyl CoA and ACP by the enzyme malonyl CoA ACP transacylase. So it's simply, it's a transfer of the group ACP from one intermediate to the next intermediate throughout. The acetylated beta-ketoacyl ACP synthase form a reaction. This from this reaction transfers its acetyl group to the malonyl ACP, which releases carbon dioxide. In the NADPH dependent reaction, this acetoacetyl ACP is reduced to the D-beta hydroxybutyryl ACP by the beta-ketoacyl ACP reductase enzyme. And then this D-beta hydroxybutyryl ACP is converted to the alpha-beta transbutyryl or butanoyl ACP by the enzyme D-beta hydroxybutyryl ACP dehydratase, which releases water. In an NADPH dependent reaction later, this alpha-beta transbutanoyl ACP is converted to butyryl ACP with the help of enoyl ACP reductase enzyme, which oxidizes NADPH and produces NADP+. To produce a longer fatty acids, this butyryl ACP needs to recycle and do the recycling reactions from 2 to 6 or more times that will keep on adding the hydrocarbon content to it. Okay, and in this case it enters the pathway at step 2 in the place of the acetyl ACP to produce the palmitoyl ACP. That is the part where they're involved with, and the cycle keeps on repeating at least 2-6 times to get what is known as here the palmitoyl CoA. The final step is the biosynthesis of palmitate, is the release of the fatty acyl group from ACP by the specific enzyme palmitoyl thioesterase, which cleaves that other ACP group out, because that should not be present in palmitic acid. Now note, only the last two carbon atoms provided with green here, they come directly from acetyl CoA, and the rest of them are originated from the malonyl CoA that we have provided, because rest of the processes that keeps on repeating from 2 to 6th stage go with this malonyl CoA, and the only first two denoted here with the green came from the acetyl CoA.